What's up, guys? Frank here with Scott Lewis of Carnifex, who has a killer new album, Graveside Confessions, coming at you September 3rd. Scott, it's good to see you alive, healthy, and stoked on a new record, man.
Yeah, I think it's good to be alive. It's good to be healthy, and I'm glad we have a record that we all believe in.
Hell yeah. I know that you mentioned this particular record is personal, you know, for every member of the band. Of course, you know, given we just went through a global pandemic, I don't know if it meant that, you know, it had something to do with the quarantine experience or if there's something else that contributes to that. The tone and subject matter of the record is pretty heavy stuff for sure.
Yeah, I think it's probably an all of the above situation. You know, I mean, I definitely went into the shutdown with a bunch of my own baggage already, you know, no doubt about that. And then I think what I kind of realized about the quarantine, maybe it was similar for you, is it sort of compounded everything. And I think if you had some emotional baggage beforehand, it probably was examined under a magnifying glass at some point on our, you know, year and a half journey through the pandemic and the shutdown and stuff. So I was right there too. You know, I wasn't immune to questioning every decision I made in my life prior to the moment I was in. And I think we put that in the record. But you know, there's also good stuff in the record, like where it's record number 8. We're a little bit better at writing records now. We've gotten okay at it. And then I would say, to contrast the kind of, you know, emotional or, you know, tangible challenges that the pandemic brought for bands, one thing that we really did enjoy was the writing and recording process, like just being all on our own. Like, it was forced, yes, but in a weird way, it ended up being like a blessing in disguise. And I think we got a pretty amazing record because it was like, well, it's just the band and you have this time and might as well make a record. Like, no extra producers, no schedule from the label, no impending tour, you know, just time and the studio.
I'm guessing that made for kind of a relaxed atmosphere, almost sort of like going back to the beginning of the band and where you weren't so pressured to get stuff done on a certain schedule. And, you know,
you're right. Yeah. It was one thing too, we try to do is like, we said, let's have fun. And I think on World War X, fun was not on the list. You know, there were a lot of things that we set out to accomplish with World War X, but fun wasn't on that list. You know, it was very serious. It was very much about trying to like prove ourselves beyond kind of this old vision that we're just kind of a victory deathcore band or a MySpace band. And it was like, we really were trying to be bigger than the genre and try to, you know, be the deathcore band that gets the Slipknot tours, you know, be the deathcore band that doesn't just play 300 cap clubs.
You know, despite where they started, like, they don't want to have anything to do with that tag. And you know, yourself have just mentioned that several times that you're a deathcore band and you kind of wear that proudly. And you know, how do you personally feel about, you know, like that tag and people calling you deathcore and the bands that don't want to be called that anymore?
Well, I think it has a lot to do with where we started. And, you know, when we started, deathcore genre, kind of as we all came to know it, it didn't exist. You know, yes, Despised Icon existed. I mean, yeah, Through the Eyes of the Dead was out there. JFAC was out there. And I guess the concept of deathcore was becoming a thing, but it certainly wasn't widespread. Metalcore was still, you know, king of everything. So when we came along and said, well, here's blast beats, breakdowns, and gutturals, we were really discouraged from that and made, you know, really got made fun of for that. And that wasn't just by people on the internet. It was, you know, Revolver, Decibel, Outburn, Metal Sucks, all these places. We didn't start Carnifex to be a deathcore band. We started Carnifex because, you know, I met Sean and we decided, dude, what is Cannibal Corpse and Bleeding Through sound like if you put them in one song? When the genre got, you know, kind of popularized, but then also very polarized, it was sort of like, oh, guys, we're a deathcore band. Turns out deathcore sucks. Wow, okay, that's a surprise. You know, now there's a small change towards deathcore because you have newer bands, fresh blood coming in and getting people excited again, you know, Lorna, Slaughter, Brand, those types of bands. And they don't seem to be getting as discouraged from being who they are as that first generation was.
Absolutely. And those bands obviously look up to bands like yours. And I think you're a mainstay, obviously, you know, in what you do. And I've always enjoyed it, you know, watching you guys live is super sick. So
I appreciate that. Thank you.
And, you know, the lyrical theme of Carnifex has always been, you know, really grim and dark, depressive, angry, and discuss topics of death, suicide, self-harm, you know, coming out of a global pandemic where most of the world kind of felt an impact on mental health. I'm sure yourself included, you know, as we talked about, do you feel that your lyrics kind of hit differently? You know, like, do you look back on them and you're like, oh shit, like, you know, that fucks me up what I wrote.
It is kind of funny when I go back to some of those super early songs, and maybe I kind of had some idea in my mind what they were about, but really it was just like a purge, you know. It was kind of like, I sort of, you know, I get called out, I still get called out for it. It's like, you know, the kind of just like live journal lyrics, and it's kind of like this, you know, stream of consciousness of like, here's where I'm at. I'm just going to put it on the page as like, not that I'm trying to, you know, not that I have some great answer and the culmination is the lyrics. It's more like the question is the lyrics. It's like, I'm going to put it out there where I'm at. And it's me at the beginning, not me in the middle or at the end. And so when I go back and read some of the lyrics from the first albums, I'm like, damn, like, wow, these, I'm talking about myself here, but I didn't know it at the time. You know, reading those lyrics, it's like, you know, they do still have an impact on me. And those feelings that I didn't really have a grasp on that at the time, I'm still learning, still in the beginning of my writing journey. I'm like, damn, you know, like, I still have those feelings to this day. So I can still tell myself, hey, remember the lyrics, not as don't forget the words, but remember their meaning. And I can go there and be like, yeah, this song's just as powerful as it was 15 years ago. And I think that can relate to the fan base as well. That's my hope.
Yeah. It's, you know, something to be consistent 15 years later and still believe in what you did, you know? And as you mentioned, you went back in time and revisited that early record, you know, Dead in My Arms. And, you know, that's not something that you really hear from a lot of bands, you know, to go back and re-record a couple of songs. Where you did recorded three songs on this one. Was there something about these three songs in particular that made you want to go back and redo them?
They are songs that we really love. Like, I still think they like hold up pretty good. You know, if you're kind of listening to some of the stuff that's coming out right now, that's getting a ton of hype, it's like, yeah, you can kind of see where it started. And I think that's kind of the fun in the whole thing. And, you know, the guys in the band, all of us, we're big watchers of culture. But it also kind of gives us a roadmap for what's coming up, which I think is a good thing, because we can go into this time where people are sort of appreciating what we've always done more. But we have the advantage of like, well, we've been doing this for a long time, so we can really serve it up right now, you know?
Yeah. And I mean, you know, you have new songs. The new album's great, by the way, you know, and you have new stuff, you have some old stuff, and you even have a cover on the record, of course, you know, the Korn cover of Dead Bodies Everywhere, which was really an unlikely pairing. You know, I mean, it's such a great cover. I actually didn't even realize that it was a cover the first time I heard it. And
yeah, you know, that happened to us on Warped Tour. Actually, we were playing the Heretic Anthem, our cover of Heretic Anthem, and we're doing a little meet and greet at the table, and this guy comes up, he goes, man, I really like that new 666 song. And I'm like, thanks, dude. You know, I'm like, I'll just let you figure that one out.
right, yeah. I'll take the writing credit on that, you know.
Yeah, I'm glad you had fun, man.
But, you know, are you guys, it sounds like you're fans of you know, nu metal and kind of like where it started with Korn and Slipknot and stuff. Is that fair to say?
Oh, absolutely. I think, you know, it's like we didn't start as deathcore fans because it wasn't there to be a fan of. You know, Carnifex is really the combination of mine and Sean's influence. And Sean is a huge Slipknot fan. He's a huge Korn fan. Joey Jordison in particular is his favorite drummer of all time. If you listen to his fills on basically all the records, but really on the early records, they're Jordison fills. They're right there. You know, it's like he's wearing his influence on his sleeve. And then even in how he approached being a band member, you know, Joey was a big writing force in Slipknot. And so that's why he's always been, you know, the kind of the backbone writer of Carnifex. Was he was trying to be like Joey, and, you know, to the benefit of Carnifex. And then on the other side of the table is my influence, where I sort of skipped nu metal. I went grunge. You know, Nine Inch Nails, Manson, Cradle of Filth, Dimmu Borgir, Emperor. So I kind of went around nu metal. I went around bands like Pantera. I didn't even listen to Pantera until like they had already disbanded, and basically, because I was already listening to Immortal, Satyricon, Dissection, In Flames, At the Gates, Fetus, Cannibal, Mortician, Disgorge. Like that was my shit. So I had sort of been like, Pantera, that shit's on the radio. That's not extreme. So I kind of had a metal elitist complex when I was like 14, 15, because I thought I was like, I'm into the good shit. You guys are listening to the radio, you know? Right. And so I did a bunch of bands during that time, you know, didn't really get anywhere. But then by chance, I meet Sean, and it was sort of that perfect amalgam of like, oh, it's like, I want to do Slipknot stuff and nu metal stuff, but I also really like this band Bleeding Through. He also loves Cannibal, and it's like, that's just where it came from. So I think it's just a this meets that, you know, it wasn't really like orchestrated.
Right. I mean, you were speaking about Joey and, you know, like the influence that he's had. I mean, have you guys ever had an interaction with Joey Jordison along the way?
No, the shows that we played with Slipknot, Jay had already been playing drums for him. I think we got to see Joey play with the band at one of the festivals we played in Europe a while back, but we weren't like sharing the stage with them or anything. I could be wrong, but I think Sean was a sound engineer at a club here in San Diego, and when we weren't on the road a while back, and I think he was working at one of the clubs that Joey's other band played while they're on tour, but that's it.
Gotcha. Well, yeah. I know you're going to be doing a whole lot of press on this record, and I figured we'd have a little bit of fun with the question generator if you're up for it.
Yeah, let's do it.
Do you prefer Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram?
Instagram, I guess. It's the only one I'm on, so I got to go with IG.
What's the best way to get a response from you? Is it a phone call, a text, or an email?
Oh, either a text or an email. I really don't answer my phone that much. And I have to say, like, really, there's very little band business done by telephone. You know what I mean? Like, it's just not, I rarely am I doing stuff on a phone call. Obviously, an interview is different, or maybe you're trying to get a brainstorming session with a few people, but usually it's an email. So yeah, I would say email probably.
Which do you not enjoy, doing laundry, dishes, or mopping?
Well, you know, I got pretty good at those chores this last year and a half. I guess mopping would be the worst. Yeah, because it's just kind of like so many parts to it.
Is the best junk meal pizza, tacos, or falafel?
I mean, you named, you know, some meal staples there. So I don't really like to be called junk, but I mean, tacos, you know, I am from Southern California, so I wouldn't call them junk, but I guess probably tacos, man.
Yeah, no joke. If you could be only one, would you rather be successful, handsome, or happy?
I guess happy. If it's that easy, I'll take happy.
Do you prefer small venues, theaters, or festivals?
The real answer is I just love a show where I see the fans lost in the moment. If it's in a club, a theater, a festival, a fucking barn in someone's backyard. Had great experiences playing backyard shows too. Had horrible experiences playing backyard shows. But yeah, for me, it's about connecting with people I don't know and probably will never speak to directly, but we have this communal language, and that's the music that we're both participating in at the moment.
Beautifully said. If a tour van, if your tour van breaks down in an area with no internet, do you grab your phone, a book, or a drink?
Well, probably my phone and start marching, because we've been with, this has happened. You know, it's really, it's just us out on the road, you know, it's just us and the band. And then we have a very small crew with us. So if the van breaks down, we're figuring out what the hell to do. And it's funny, we do have a funny story. I remember we're doing a van tour. We were out in Indianapolis, middle of the night, 3 a.m. Fred was driving, And then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, literally our transmission just makes a fucking clunking sound and then just stops. And like, you know, you hit the throttle all you want, it's like not getting to the wheels, right? It's just revving the engine. So Fred like coasts to the side, just transmission fluid all over the freeway. You know, we're on the side of the freeway and we're like, same deal, like no cell service. We're like, damn, all right, well, there is a gas station at this exit that's whatever, a half mile, three quarters of a mile up ahead. We just got to walk there or walk to service, call a tow truck, get this thing towed, you know? And as we're walking down the freeway, a cop comes by, pulls over, and he goes, you know, it's illegal to walk on the freeway. We go, well, you see our van, we're broken down, we're trying to get to the exit. And he goes, just letting you know, and then just drives away. Okay. Well, keep marching at the gas station. Like, all right. And then we get to the gas station, you know, do what we got to do. And then we got a trucker actually like looped us around and we got kind of got lucky. So yeah, we'd be grabbing the phone and trying to figure it out.
Right on. Yeah. And cops always to the rescue, you know?
Right. We still laugh about it. Like no offer of a ride. No. Hey, you know, it's illegal to walk on the freeway. We're like, okay, we just sit in the car then. I don't, you know,
right.
Trying to get this thing solved, but thank you.
Right. Well, Scott, it's great talking to you, man. I'll see you out there with my buds in the Black Dahlia Murder very soon. Guys, if you haven't yet pre-ordered the new Carnifex record coming this September, it is a beast. Scott, thanks again, man.
Cool. Thanks for having me, man.